So, hello and welcome again to the lecture course on relativity and cosmology. You have now seen Einstein's equations with the geometric and the matter part. We have spent some time to understand this also from a variational principle from the Einstein-Hilbert action. And we have also done this for the right-hand side for the team you knew. So far, this has been a little bit abstract. But today we will discuss examples for the energy momentum tensor, and we will discuss examples that are of much use in also what follows later. Of course, the simplest example is just vacuum. Also, this is important. T mu nu is zero and will only have the cosmological constant. This we discuss later. What we discuss today is dust, which is the simplest, then ideal fluid, which is a generalization of dust, and the electromagnetic field. And these three cases already cover a big part of applications. So the first example is dust. Now, dust is just the name. We will also use it in cosmology as a model for galaxies, which is certainly not dust. So dust means the following: non-interacting matter, entirely characterized by its density, by its mass density, or if you want, energy density. So that is what dust here means, independent of the literal meaning. So that's non-interacting matter characterized solely by its density. I call it rho naught of x, and this rho naught stands for the mass or energy density as measured by a co-moving observer. And we set speed of light equal to 1. So this here is the mass or energy density as measured by a co-moving observer. And we imagine the following. We have a world line of such dust particles, or many of those. So this is the world, these are world lines of dust particles. And to each world line, of course, at every point we can associate a four velocity vector. So here that's u mu of x, and as usual u mu is dx mu over d tau. You know that already from earlier considerations. And for that case, I mean, the energy momentum tensor has the following simple form: rho naught times u mu times u nu. Okay, why is that? Yeah, first, it's the only possible construction that you can write down if you only have the rho naught and the mu available. But you can also give a further justification if you look at special relativity. So motivation. So first, only possible construction out of rho naught and u mu. The second is special relativity. So there we know how the four vector looks like. So u mu is gamma times 1 v. And so if you insert this here, and let's do it for the version with upper indices, then you get t 0, 0 is rho naught dt over d tau squared. This is just the gamma squared. So we have gamma squared times rho naught, which we may call just rho. And rho is a density with respect to an observer at rest. That is an observer who sees the dust particles moving, in contrast to the co-moving observer, who who measures rho naught. Now recall that rho is not an invariant. It depends on the system. So rho is the density with respect to an observer at rest. Intuitively, you can, understand this gamma square factor as follows. Density is, energy density is energy over volume, and the volume V is gamma to the minus 1 times the volume V naught, of the co-moving observer, and this gamma to the minus 1 is the Lorentz factor that comes from the Lorentz contraction, which is in one direction only. This is not in three directions. This is why we have gamma to the minus 1. And the energy, is gamma times m. So from this you get rho is E over V is gamma squared m over V naught. And this is gamma squared or not. So from this heuristic consideration, you can understand that here a gamma squared factor occurs. But anyway, even without that, if you have only this quantity available and the four velocity, this is more or less the only thing you can write down. Now, let us go to special relativity, and you recall that we have the conservation of the energy momentum tensor T mu nu comma nu equals zero, and in one of the exercises, you are asked to insert here the expression for dust and look separately at the zero and space components. So there you find rather quickly that if you write it down for mu equals zero, you get d rho over dt plus nabla rho V is equal to zero. And of course, this is a well-known equation already from non-relativistic physics, the continuity equation. If you look for the spatial components, mu is 1, 2, 3, you find that rho is, the equation is rho times dV over dt plus V times nabla V is equal to zero. And also this equation should be familiar to you. It's the so-called Euler equation in the special case of vanishing pressure and vanishing external force. So this here is the Euler equation for vanishing pressure and vanishing external force. Now, the full Euler equation has these additional terms, so the full Euler equation, and Euler did that in the 18th century, 1755. The full Euler equation, you have rho times dV over dt plus V times nabla V is equal to minus nabla p. This is what we will get when we add pressure. And generally, you have an external force, which here is not included because everything is within. That would be the force per volume. Now, if you add, say, a friction, viscosity, then you get additional terms. But that is beyond what Euler did. This is so-called Navier-Stokes equation that was done in the 19th century, and which we will not take into account here. So you see, by having this law, imposing it, it contains well-known laws from non-relativistic physics. That means you, even if you did not know these laws, you would have found them from relativity as consistency equations. These are energy and momentum conservation equations, as you know. In GR, we have T mu nu semicolon nu is equal to zero. which of course reduces to this in a near the origin of a locally free-falling system. And in the exercise, you are asked to show that if you insert here the equation for dust, that you get a consistency equation for the four velocity, which is this equation. Also, this equation you know, it's the geodesic equation of motion here written in terms of the four velocity. No, so this is the geodesic equation. So you see it, the geodesic equation here is not something that is postulated separately or comes from separate consideration. It has to be demanded for reasons of consistency. So the dust particles, of course, they are free particles. That's not surprising that they move on geodesics. And I should say here that this is an example, maybe the simplest, of deriving an equation of motion from at least indirectly the field equations. I mean, these are not the field equations, but the field equations demand that this be valid. And so from this you get this. So this is in contrast to, say, electrodynamics, classical electrodynamics, where the Lorentz force is some additional law that does not follow from the Maxwell equations. And mathematical relativists study this problem in detail for the full Einstein equation. So it's believed that for the full Einstein equations, you can also show that test particles move on geodesics, but it's very subtle if you go to mathematical details, and I don't say anything more about this here. Okay, so far for the dust. Now I have to erase the blackboard. So the second example, which is a generalization of dust, is the ideal fluid. So I could have started directly with this, but it's convenient to separate the dust, because also in cosmology we shall see that this is separately an important application. So we have, in addition to the density and the four velocity, we have an isotropic pressure field P of X. And dust follows as a special example if you set P equals zero. Now we make the following ansatz. We have now two scalars available, scalar function. So we have T mu nu is rho nu mu nu. And now we add the following. So have a function of with P, and then we make the ansatz. Just to fit the indices, we can write here mu nu also. And recall that we also have the metric available. So we could here also add the g mu nu. So that's the only options that we have. So in special relativity, it's clear that, as before, the conservation law should give continuity and Euler equations, but now with the minus nabla p on the right-hand side. So should give the continuity and Euler equations with minus nabla p on the right-hand side. And in the exercise, you will show that this fixes this function a and b, and you get the following form for t mu nu, that t mu nu is rho zero plus p mu nu plus p times g mu nu. So that's an important expression that you should always remember, because especially in cosmology and also in astrophysics, we often make as a particular Ansatz for matter the Ansatz for the ideal fluid, and only later add, when necessary, viscosities or frictions. Now, in special relativity, of course, in inertial coordinates, you have here the eta mu nu. So, in special relativity, so in the rest system of the fluid, we have mu is 1, 0, and we have g mu nu is eta mu nu. And then if you write this as a 4 times 4 matrix, you have the following form, the t mu nu. It's clear that, I mean, you have t 0, 0, you just have the rho naught, because this here, p, these p terms, cancels with this, because g 0, 0 is minus 1. This is why if you had another convention, sign convention for the metric, you would have to write here a minus, but g 0, 0 is minus 1. So we get here the rho 0, and we have the p here on the diagonal. Now it's a isotropic pressure in the three spatial directions. Of course, you could also have an anisotropic situation. Now, this expression also, as it stands, it's a covariant expression, is also valid by the equivalence principle in general relativity. But there, of course, you have the covariant law. So in GR, we have the same expression. This expression here, but of course, we have t mu nu semicolon u equals 0. Let me make one remark on this and on the general description of matter. Now, ordinary matter obeys a non-negative energy density, and also that the pressure is not too large. So, more precisely, so this is a remark, ordinary matter obeys rho naught non-negative, and we have minus rho naught smaller equal than p smaller equal than rho naught. Now recall we have set speed of light equal to 1, otherwise you would have here rho over c squared. Now from this, from the general relation between rho and p, you can calculate the speed of sound, which is here just a metaphor for the information speed that you can have in matter. And this is c squared, as here as dp over d rho. And so this means here that cs absolute value is smaller or equal than 1, which means that the speed of sound cannot exceed the speed of light, which sounds reasonable, and we do not know of any matter that violates this. And it also means that all the influences that come from matter, they are within the light cone in general relativity. Whatever the structure of the light cone is, it's a curved light cone in general, but the propagation is inside, or at most at a boundary of this. Now, in principle, you could imagine matter forms that violate that, and in speculative theories, people have such equations of state that violate this condition. But this condition is very central if you describe ordinary matter, and it's called the so-called dominant energy condition. Dominant energy condition, which is used as an assumption in various theorems that you prove in general relativity. Now, this dominant comes from the fact that the density dominates the pressure. This is what the dominant here refers to. And if we go to a Riemann normal coordinate system, it means that it says that t 0, 0 component is bigger or equal than the absolute value of the spatial components. But in this simple situation, it's just here, the pressures. So it means again, very, very importantly, that no signal can propagate faster than the speed of light in general relativity. So far, at least at this point, for the ideal fluid, now, I mean, the only other macroscopic interaction that we have besides gravity and besides these mechanical interactions is the electromagnetic interaction. And so it's clear that the electromagnetic field is very important also for general relativity. And this is why I say some words here, some more words here on this. So this is the third example, the electromagnetic field. So you have already encountered some examples in the exercises, and you have already discussed Maxwell's equations in general relativity. But let me discuss this from a more general point of view. Okay, at the beginning, there's the action or the Lagrangian. And let me write down the electromagnetic matter Lagrangian, which is the following, in Gaussian units. Minus 1 over 16 pi, so F mu nu, F rho lambda, G u lambda, G rho, plus J mu, A mu is a standard meaning, so this is the forecurrent, the electrodynamic forecurrent, so charge and density and ordinary current, and the vector potential. And of course, this is what you have in special relativity and what you write with the help of the general metric so that it's in covariant form. And by the equivalence principle, you can take this as the ansatz for the electromagnetic field in general relativity. Now, F mu nu is the field strength, and you can write it here with covariant derivatives. Now, it's asymmetric. Tensor, but because we have here anti-symmetric, because here I have here minus sign, we can also write it with partial differentials instead of covariant. So this is the same as d mu a nu minus d mu a mu. Yeah? So it does not matter which form you use. And if I'm not mistaken, you already had in the exercises this example of Maxwell equations, or you will have, if not yet, then you know how to derive, from this Lagrangian by employing the Euler-Lagrange equations, the field equations. And so from this, you get first here the identity for the F mu nu, which is F mu nu semicolon rho equals zero, and recall these brackets, they mean total anti-symmetrization. So these are then the homogeneous Maxwell equations. You can also write this with the help of partial derivatives. So you can also have it without the covariant derivatives. So in a sense, this form is more general than the form with the metric. Also in the exercise, you have calculated the energy momentum tensor, which has the following form in Gaussian units. So it's quadratic in the field strength, and in detail, it has this here, minus 1/4 g mu nu, F rho lambda, F rho lambda. So again, this is what you get from either from the formula we had last time, the variation of the action with respect to the metric, or you can also go back to what you have perhaps heard in special relativity and just replace the eta by the G metric. Now, one important property that this has is if you calculate its trace, and the trace you get by G mu nu, T mu nu, because the trace of G itself is 4, this 4 is cancelled, and you find that this is traceless. So the electromagnetic energy momentum tensor is traceless, which is an important property, and which has to do with the conformal properties of this field. Now, in special relativity, if you calculate the team you knew by inserting or by decomposing F into the electric and the magnetic field components as usual, then you get that T00 is 1 over 8 pi, and then you have E squared plus B squared. Yeah. So the well-known expression for the energy density of the electromagnetic field. So for the T0i components, which are minus T0i upstairs, is minus 1 over 4 pi E times E or E cos Bi, which we call minus Si. And so T0i is Si. And these are the components of the so-called Poynting vector that you are, I hope, also familiar with from electrodynamics. So this here are the components of the Poynting vector, which give you the energy flux in the electromagnetic field. Now, so beware of here different signs in the literature, but you always have this connection of T zero I components to the Poynting vector. Okay, so far for the homogeneous Maxwell equations, now which you can directly get from the definition of F mu nu. Now for the inhomogeneous ones, we really have then to calculate the Euler-Lagrange equations from here, from the first line here, and this I will do next. So for the inhomogeneous Maxwell equations, we start from the Lagrangian given above, and we have then the Euler-Lagrange equation, d over dx nu is d square root of minus g lm over d mu comma nu minus d square root of minus g lm over d a mu is equal to 0. Now you take the expression given above and you vary then, or you differentiate with respect to a mu and a mu comma nu. So from this in the exercise, then you get the following equation, 1 over 4 pi square root of minus g f mu nu comma nu is the square root of minus g j mu. Now, in order to put this into different form, let me mention that for any antisymmetric tensor field, you have the following condition. So for any antisymmetric tensor field, we have that the covariant divergence can be written in the following suggestive way, 1 minus square root of minus g, and then you have the partial derivative, the ordinary divergence of this here. I mean, this you can find just from using the definition of the covariant derivative. So therefore, I mean, by using this, which is a purely mathematical identity, then you get from this that F mu nu semicolon nu is equal to 4 pi j mu. And this is the general relativistic version of the inhomogeneous Maxwell equations. In special relativity, recall we have just here a comma. Now, for the homogeneous one, we have seen that they can also be formulated entirely in terms of partial derivatives, not covariant ones. Something similar you can also do here when you define what is sometimes done, I mean, this quantity curled F mu nu, which is a density, so this is defined as square root of minus g, g mu alpha, g beta nu, F alpha beta, so you raise the indices of this with the metric, yeah, because of the symmetry or antisymmetry properties. You make here also the antisymmetrization. But important is to have the square root of minus g here. And if you use this, then you can easily convince yourself that then this equation can be written as F mu nu comma nu is 4 pi. Then you have a curled, let me write it that way, curled j mu, where this curled j mu is also the density square root of minus g times j mu. So you can have, instead of this, also this version here for the covariant general relativistic Maxwell equations. No? So this means you can write the Maxwell equations actually without using the metric if you use these quantities instead of the F mu nu. Now from this equation here, you can derive the following. When I have here a second partial derivative, also with respect to mu, then I can write square root of minus g f mu nu, comma mu mu. Then, as in the case of special relativity, because this here is anti-symmetric, and the second derivatives, they commute, the partial derivatives, so you have a symmetry, which means that for any term in this contraction, there is another term with a different, with the opposite sign, which means that this is zero because of the anti-symmetry of F mu nu. And of course, this must hold for the right-hand side. So we have 4 pi square root of minus g j mu comma mu, no, which is here this curl j mu. So you can also write this, if you recall what we had in the mathematics section, because this is a density of weight 1, so it's the same as the covariant divergence, and the g here is covariantly constant, so we have here is 4 pi square root of minus g j mu semicolon mu. No? So you see from this here that j mu semicolon mu is zero, which is a generalization of the charge conservation that you know from special relativity, where you just have a comma mu. Or you can write it here in terms of the curled current directly here as a conservation law. No? So we have here this, respectively this. No? No? So if you remember, Maxwell equations is very important that they are consistent with charge conservation. Actually, historically, this is how Maxwell found the additional term in one of the equations, because he demanded this conservation. Now, let us insert here in these equations, which are written for F, the definition of F in terms of the vector potential, and see what equations do we get in terms of A mu. So here, if you write them down this way, they look very innocent. You may think, well, it's not much more complicated than in special relativity, Maxwell equations. So yeah, you have this semicolon, but you can even write it like that. And maybe the whole treatment is as in flat space-time electrodynamics. But this impression is not quite correct. And let me explain why. So you will see that you will not get very simple equations for the vector potential itself. So let us insert F mu nu, which is Napla mu A nu minus Napla nu A mu into the inhomogeneous Maxwell equations. And so these are those. So we have F mu nu semicolon nu is 4 pi j mu. And from this you get, if you insert this and we replace this by semicolon, so we have A mu semicolon mu nu. So this means, of course, covariant derivative twice minus A mu semicolon nu nu is 4 pi j mu. Now a similar equation, you already arrive in special relativity. And what you do there, you say, they couple various components of A, but we can use a so-called gauge condition here, the Lorentz condition, which is the divergence freeness of A. And so this term is absent. And if you go to a particular gauge, and then we have an independent equation for A mu, which is just D'Alembert A mu is equal to the current, to the source. And then you have a wave equation you can solve with Green function, whatever. And you might see, okay, this you could do here, but closer inspection shows you that here we have the second covariant derivatives first with respect to mu and then with respect to nu. So to use the covariant Lorentz condition, A nu semicolon nu equals zero, you have to swap the two indices. But for the covariant derivatives, this is not the same, as you know. Covariant derivatives, second derivative, do not commute. I mean, you get this the Riemann tensor from that. So here we cannot yet use the Lorentz condition, A nu semicolon nu equal to zero. We first have to change the order of the derivatives, and from what we did in the mathematical chapter, we know that this brings into play the Riemann curvature tensor. So after you have then used this, then you can use the Lorentz condition, but you have to live with this term. So what we get by inserting this here is A mu semicolon nu nu. Actually, this is this is the second term, which we just leave, and we then insert this in the first term. We have also multiplied by minus one, and then we have minus A nu semicolon nu mu minus A alpha alpha mu mu nu is minus 4 pi j mu. Now here you see we can use A nu semicolon nu equals zero. So can use A nu semicolon nu equals zero. And this here you see we have here the contraction, which just gives then the Ricci tensor. So this here is then A alpha R alpha mu. So we have here the generalization of the old term in special relativity, which is the covariant D'Alembert operator, which I call here with a box G, A mu. And now we have a new term, minus R mu nu A nu. So this is nu compared to special relativity is equal to minus 4 pi j mu. So you see what we get is now really something different. And you have here this coupling to the gravitational field. You know, because the gravitational field, of course, carries energy. and or reacts to any energy, so the electromagnetic field has energy and creates a gravitational field that back reacts on the motion of charges and behavior of fields. Of course, you could just take an external gravitational field and neglect this back reaction, but from a fundamental point of view, you have to take this into account. Now, the arm you knew, you could, of course, now take from the Einstein field equations. Then you see explicitly how complicated this self-interaction is. No? So we have here, if you recall, R mu nu minus 1/2 G mu nu R is kappa T mu nu. And let us first calculate the trace of this. So we have the trace. The trace of this is 4, so this is minus 2 R is kappa times T mu mu. So from this you get R is equal to minus kappa T mu mu. And then you can insert this back into the Einstein equation. So you have an equation only for R mu nu without the R, but the right-hand side has an additional term, namely the trace of the energy momentum tensor. So that's what you sometimes also read in the literature as an equivalent writing of the Einstein field equation. Instead of the more standard form here, with these two terms, you only have here one term for the curvature, but then you have the two terms here for the T mu nu. One term is trace. Now this I can insert here now into this equation. So the R mu nu occurs here, and I can replace it by that. So we have here then D'Alembert G A mu minus kappa T mu nu minus 1/2 delta mu nu T lambda lambda A nu is equal to minus 4 pi J mu. Now, we have seen before that for the electromagnetic field, the trace is zero. So this term is absent. But we still have the first term. So we still have the D'Alembert G A mu minus kappa T mu nu A nu is equal to minus 4 pi J mu. No? And for this here now, you must insert the energy momentum tensor of the electromagnetic field that we had written down earlier. And if you do that, and let me just do that here, then you have D'Alembert J A mu minus kappa, is kappa over 4 pi F mu rho F nu rho minus 1/4 F rho lambda F rho lambda times A nu is equal to minus 4 pi J mu. Now, so that's now really the equation that you get for the vector potential of the electromagnetic field when you take into account its coupling with gravity. Now, you see here, you have here the covariant generalization of the wave operator. That's fine. That's what you would have expected anyway. But now you have here this complicated nonlinear interaction with itself. That is, this coupling with the gravitational field generates a nonlinear self-interaction of the electromagnetic field. And this is very complicated. So the electromagnetic field has energy, and this creates a gravitational field, and this gravitational field interacts with the electromagnetic field, and so on. So you see, in spite of, say, this having a very similar form to the flat space case, if you go into the more details, they look rather nasty. And this, of course, has to do with the nonlinear, with two things, the nonlinear features of the gravitational field and this universal interaction of gravity with matter, or with non-gravitational fields. As I said, in many applications, you can assume that you neglect this back reaction, you just have a pre-given space-time gravitational field, and then you calculate a propagation of your Maxwell fields, and that's fine for many purposes. But if you're discussing more fundamental issues, then you have to take this into account. And this gives, before we end this discussion of the electromagnetic field, I will present you one paradox, or at least apparent paradox, that has puzzled many minds in the history of relativity. And its resolution, and this paradox is about, a freely falling electric charge. Does it radiate or does it not radiate? And why this is a paradox, you will see in a minute. Now we have formulated the general relativistic Maxwell equation and seen that they generate a complicated, the interaction with the gravitational field generates a complicated self-interaction in electrodynamics. Now at the end of this section, let me discuss a very interesting and maybe somewhat puzzling point, namely the question, does a freely falling charge radiate? Does a freely falling charge radiate? Now, why is this a puzzling question? Because you can give arguments for both possible answers, for the answer yes and for the answer no. How do the arguments go? Now, the first argument goes as follows. We know from the non-relativistic electrodynamics that an accelerated charge radiates. So, you know this formula, at least for a non-relativistic acceleration, but you can also give the formula for relativistic acceleration. So, because this holds in the limit of, or should hold in the limit of weak gravitational fields, I would expect that when a charge falls, of course, it's accelerated in this non-relativistic sense, and it should radiate. No? So charge should radiate. Yeah, because the nature here of the acceleration does not enter, and in the Newtonian limit, of course, you could have a freely fall, just a particular type of acceleration. Now, the second argument goes as such. We have the equivalence principle. So this means free falling charge is inertial. So when you follow this free falling charge, then of course it's at rest with you, and you should not expect it to radiate. So from this, it means that the gravitational field is transformed away. So the charge is inertial. So the charge should not radiate. Now it's obvious to everyone that not both arguments can be true at the same time, because otherwise you would find that the charge should both radiate and not radiate. So what is correct? If you like, you can now stop the presentation and think about yourself, and then maybe switch on and see what I tell you. So what is correct? Now let us first address A. Maybe this non-relativistic formula, maybe it does not hold anymore if you take into account full relativity. So we have to check this. So does this still hold? Does this still hold in the presence of gravity? So that you say, well, we know from Einstein that gravitational acceleration is special because it's in reality inertial motion, and that maybe then we cannot apply that formula. Now to test this, we can do it very general. But we can, for example, consider a charge on a circular orbit in linearized gravity and assume the arm you need to be fixed there. So we get only the terms from the D'Alembert operator. So let us do the g mu nu is eta mu nu plus twice psi mu nu, and let us assume the harmonic gauge that this divergence is equal to 1/2 of the derivative of the trace. And then we get from the formula that we had discussed before the following. I just give this to you. I mean, one has to convince yourself. You have to that this is true. So this only comes from the covariant Lagrangian, and so this gives you the ordinary. This comes from the covariant D'Alembertian. So it gives you the standard D'Alembertian plus correction terms. And these correction terms are two terms that I write here on the right-hand side. So this here is, again, the flat space form of the wave equation for AMU. So, and it's from this equation that you can calculate this radiation formula. No? So from this here, from here, one gets dE in corresponding approximations is proportional to this. So this term here, you see, in the situation of small gravitational field, has only small terms. I mean, from the psi here and from the psi derivatives which are here. So you wouldn't expect that these spoil any arguments based on this, which is also what you would expect. I mean, if these terms would spoil this, then it would mean that even for weak gravitational fields, I mean, results from this were not correct as you learned them in your standard classes. So this gives only small corrections to dE over dt. Okay, this is very short argument. One can also extend this, and one can show that the limit for weak gravitational fields is really this limit here. So this would mean that, yeah, in that limit, we can take for A the gravitational acceleration. I mean, if I let here fall something, from my point of view of the laboratory, it does not matter whether this comes from gravity or from acceleration of another field. So the charge should radiate. This is what we learned from that. But what then about argument B? What about the equivalence principle, which is so fundamental in relativity? So B, again, let us consider a simple case, a charge on a circular orbit that is freely falling. I mean, like a charge in the International Space Station that circles around the Earth. It's freely falling, and it follows the geodesic. So, for example, charge on circular orbit is freely falling. And let us assume that the motion is non-relativistic, so much smaller than speed of light. So let us then see what is the main part of the electromagnetic radiation, which range of wavelengths is it emitted. So the main part of the electromagnetic radiation is emitted has the wavelengths, has a lambda, which is speed of light, which I take into account over the frequency. Now, the main part is from the frequency itself of the orbital motion itself. So we can insert here that phi v is omega times r is 2 pi nu r. And so this is c over v times 2 pi r, where r is the radius of the charge that circles in that orbit. And you see here, if you assume or have to assume non-relativistic motion here, then this here is much bigger than 1, which means that lambda is much bigger than r. So the typical wavelengths that the radiated charge emits is much bigger than the radius of that. But if you then recall discussion in electrodynamics, this means that the near zone of the emission and even beyond is many lambdas. The radiation zone is if you're very far away, for many, many lambdas, but the near zone is certainly a couple of lambdas. And you see, then you are already outside, for many wavelengths, this circular orbit. And of course, the gravitational field is no longer homogeneous on that scale. Now, if you have, say, a circular motion around the Earth, and the Earth has a gravitational field, and the near zone already of that emission is many times the radius of the Earth. So, recalling that the equivalence principle is locally valid, you can no longer apply the equivalence principle. No? So, here from that means that the gravitational field, or I should say the near zone, and beyond that comprises several lambda. So this region is much bigger than R, and the gravitational field is no longer homogeneous there, which means that the equivalence principle, EP, which is local, is no longer applicable. Okay, this means, because this investigation here is correct, this means that the charge really is radiating, the accelerated charge also in general relativity, even if it's on geodesic motion. But this is not in contrast with the equivalence principle, because the equivalence principle does not hold on such a scale where you see the radiation. Yeah, of course, we define radiation by the radiation zone, which is the far zone of the radiation. And this is for an observer that is far away. An observer that is falling with the charge does not see anything. So for the freely falling charge, the charge does not radiate. But if you have a big surface around all that motion, then you could, in principle, check that energy is emitted. Yeah, this has, a long history. It can be traced back to the famous book by Wolfgang Pauli on relativity, a book he wrote at the age of 19. And is still splendid, and one of the certainly best books of the day. But he, in that book, made this mistake, arguing that because of the equivalence principle, the charge should not radiate. And it was understood over the next 40 years that how to bring these points A and B together, and the details are actually not so easy. I will not enter the discussion here in the literature. If you like, you can check, a very nice book by Rohrlich, which is with the title Classical Charge Particles. There you can learn almost everything about classical charge particles. You should read the second edition, because between the first and the second edition, many developments have been done on this question. So if you find in your library an old edition of the 1960s, then maybe that's not what I recommend, because he has added material in later. So you see, there are interesting conceptual questions arising if you go from special to general relativity, but at the end you get a consistent and very interesting picture. So in the next section we discuss what remains from the conservation laws that we have in special relativity. And we have, of course, charge conservation, but we also have energy and momentum conservation. Do they still hold here? And if not, I mean, what is replaced? And the last section then in this chapter 6 is more or less a review of various features that have to do with structures of the full theory. I mean, that each of it would demand maybe many hours of discussion, but I want to give at least a review of important topics such as the initial value problem for solving the Einstein equations, or what is Mach's principle. And after that, we go to a particular situation. So the next chapter 7 will be gravitational waves. Thank you for today, and until next time.